Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture series. So today's topic is floods. The course that I am running here is Engineering Hydrology in Department of Civil Engineering, MNIT Allahabad. To start with the definition, a flood is an unusually high stage in a river. Normally, the level at which river overflows its banks and inundates the adjoining area. So you know it pretty well, what is a flood? It's a high stage. So now when we design a hydraulic structure, you know, we want a peak flow. What do we want? We want the peak flow. And with the peak flow, there is always an assigned frequency. Okay. Now frequency, you all know, is you understand in the form of time period or the probability of occurrence, you know? So this we have studied before, Gumble method, etc. We had seen, you know, where the probability is 1/T, you know. So we'll discuss them again. So there are a number of methods: rational method, empirical formulas, unit hydrograph, flood frequency analysis, you know. This we'll study in detail, and the use of a particular method depends on the desired objective, the available data, or the importance of the project. Okay, so now first we start with the rational method. Simply, the formula for the rational method is QP equals to CAI, you know, where C is the coefficient of runoff, A is the catchment area, you know, and I here is the intensity of the rainfall. But the T that we are using here should be greater than the TC. Now let's understand what is TC. TC is the time of concentration. Okay, so this is the flood hydrograph shown to you. This is the time period of the rainfall. Here the rainfall ends, and here the recession occurs. Okay, TC is the time of concentration when all the parts of the basin starts contributing to the runoff. That's how we define the TC. Now this formula has been slightly modified in this form, wherein the units area is now in kilometer square, the C is same, but I is in millimeter per hour. So usually we use millimeter per day, but here it's used hour. So the factor 3.6 comes in the denominator. Otherwise, it's a common formula, QP equals to CIA. Now let's see what are the methods for calculating the time of concentration. So in the US practice formula, this CTL is a constant, N is a constant. These are the basin and the region constants. Now S is of course the slope, okay, and L is the length of the channel. This is basin length along the main water course from basin divide to gauging station. Okay, so let's understand this with the figure here. So let's say this is my catchment. Okay, now in this catchment, if let's say this is my these are the streams. Okay, so what L means here is L is the distance measured along this line, this main channel, up till the end point, you know? So from this point to this point along the main channel. Now what is LC? LC is the distance along the main water course. It's the same, the main water course from gauging station, again this is my gauging station, to a point opposite to the watershed centroid in kilometers. So what we do is we find the watershed centroid. Let's say this is the centroid here. Okay, sorry, this is the centroid here. Now the point will be on the main water course, you know? So let me draw it again here. Okay, so let me draw it here. Okay, so let's say the centroid lies here, you know? So let's say centroid lies here. So my point would be here. So this will be my LC, and this entire length will be length L. I hope it's clear to you. So that's how you can measure the time of concentration. Now there are some empirical equations like Kriplich equation, you know? So in 1940 Kriplich gave this equation, which depends on L. Again, L is the same, the maximum length of travel, S is the slope, you know? There's nothing fancy here. So S is the slope of the catchment, this is delta H by L. Now this TC, the same equation has been rewritten in this form, you know? So there is nothing but a simple calculation where you substitute this delta H by L from S. So if you substitute delta H by L instead of S, and you simplify this, you get this equation where K is this. So just a simple algebraic equation. Now, what is rainfall intensity? How do you calculate this IC? You know, that we call the IC. It's a rainfall intensity. What we measure is corresponding to a duration TC. You know, so we always measure for the duration TC, you know, and the desired probability of accidents T is equals to 1 by P. We always take the return period as same, and this we can find from the rainfall frequency duration relationship. You know, so this formula is given. So these all are constants. K is a constant. You know, T is the required return period. You know, X is a constant. TC is the time of concentration. A is again a constant. N is a constant. So these are the constant for a basin area. You know, now when we're designing any structure, so let's say we're designing a dam. You know, so dams have 50 to 100 year return period. You know, these are 25 to 50 is for earthen dams. You know, for small outlets, vegetated waterways, we have lesser time period. We do not worry about those. You know, so for dams, we mostly worry. So that's why we keep it little bit high. Now what is runoff coefficient? As I told, when we measured the peak flow, it was CIA. You know, so the C is the runoff coefficient. How much runoff is being generated from that particular area? You know, so nothing fancy here. So this is, let's say, an average runoff coefficient you want to estimate. You know, so let's say there is a basin here, and there are area 1, area 2, area 3, area 4. Four areas are there, each having C1, C2, C3, and C4 as their runoff coefficient. So average runoff coefficient that you can find is C1 A1 plus C2 A2 plus and so on, divided by A1 plus A2 plus up to 1 and so on. So using this formula, you can calculate the runoff coefficient. This is the weighted equivalent runoff coefficient. Now let's take an example here. So we have an urban catchment having an area of 85 hectare. The slope is 0.006, and the length of travel of water, this is L, is given as 950, and the maximum depth of rainfall for a return period, 25 year return period, is given. So this is the depth of the rainfall, 17, 26, 40, these are all in mm. So as the time increases, duration increases, we see that the rainfall is increasing. Now what we want to find first of all, so the question is, we have to design a culvert for return period of 25 years, and we have to estimate the peak flow rate, that is Q peak. We have to estimate runoff coefficient is given to us, right? So these all data are given to us. So let's apply the Kirpich formula that requires the area that we know and the slope S. So using the area and the slope, let me show you again the Kirpich formula. So this was length of the channel and the slope. So we have put the length of the channel 950 and the slope 0.006. So we get 27.4 minutes as the time of concentration. Now for this time of concentration, we know that the depth will be in between these. So we find the depth for a point 27.4 minutes. So we apply this formula, 50 minus 40 divided by 10. Of course, you know, simple interpolation thing. So 47.4 is what we get here as the interpolated rainfall depth. Now what is the average intensity? This 47.4 is the depth accumulated over a period of 27.4 minutes. So the average depth that we get is 103.8 after applying a factor of 60, that gives the value in millimeter per hour, of course. And using the formula CI, the average depth, area, so area is given as 85 hectares. So if you convert the area in kilometers square, it becomes 0.85, and divide by 3.6 is the correction factor, the unit correction factor. So that's how you get the QPS, 7.35 meter cube per second. Now let's take another example. Here you are given with the different land use types: roads, lawn, residential area, industrial area. Different areas are given and the runoff coefficients are given. So we just have to find the equivalent runoff coefficient. It's a simple C1 A1 plus C2 A2 plus C3 A3 and so on. So you get the runoff coefficient as 0.36. You can try that. Now for the peak discharge, there are some empirical formula also. So we use the runoff coefficient method, rational formula. Now we'll see some empirical formulas. So this CD is the Dickens constant, you know, that varies between 6 to 30. So for different regions, the CD value is given. Now area is of course the catchment area in kilometer square. You simply put the catchment area, you will get the peak discharge for that particular basin. So that basin has to be located in this particular regions. Similarly, rivers also. So I think we have discussed these things before also. Now CR is the rivers constant. So this is 6.8 for areas within 80 km from the east coast. Like that, as it goes far, it becomes 8.5. For areas near hills, so these are mostly for the Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, right? So that's how you can find the QP. A is of course the area in kilometer square. Similarly, we have the English formula. This is applicable in Western Ghats in Maharashtra, right? So nothing fancy. So now we go for some flood frequency studies. So these things we have seen earlier also. So let's say you are given with the number of runoffs for different years. So you arrange them in the descending order, of course, and the probability of occurrence will be mth position divided by n is the total number of years plus 1. N is the total number of events in the data, m is the order at which it's occurring, and of course the inverse of this p will be your time period. So once you get the probability of occurrence, you can of course get the probability of occurrence r times in n successive years. So that is simple by the binomial formula ncr pr qn minus r. So this you can do here. Now for an example, the floods have been arranged 160, 135, 128, 116, like that. 50 years of flood has been arranged. So the return period for this first case would be first position divided by 51, this is the probability, and the time period will be 1 by p, that is 51. So it's a simple calculation you can do. That's how you can arrange them. And so then what we do is you plot a curve of discharge versus time. So you plot a curve. So how the discharge varies with the return period. So let's say you got this discharge versus time period. And you can, what you can do is you can fit a curve, and using this curve you can estimate the peak flood for any given return period. So this is called the flood frequency studies, and there are a number of formulas given for that. So Chow in 1951 has shown that the frequency distribution functions follow this equation. Xt is x bar plus k sigma. Xt is any variate. For our case, it's a discharge for the return period t, will be the mean discharge or the mean variate plus standard deviation of the data. In our case, it's a standard deviation of the discharges, and k is any frequency factor. Now this k can be anything that depends on the number of distribution that we are using. It can be Gumble, log Pearson type 3, or log normal. Now whatever distribution we are using, this k is different. Now let's see the Gumble's distribution. So Gumble's distribution says that probability of occurrence of any event equal to or greater than x0. x0 is the is any particular value that we have chosen, is 1 minus exponential to the power minus exponential to the power minus y. This is the equation that Gumble gave probability. Now in this equation, y is given by alpha times x minus a, where a is x bar minus 0.45005 sigma x, and alpha is 1.2825 by sigma x. So when you combine all these equations, the only variable in this equation is y. So from this equation we get y is equals to, in from these three equations we get y equals to 1.285 x minus x bar. You can do a simple calculation upon sigma x plus 0.577. This equation is for infinite number of data sets, remember that. We'll use it for lesser number of data sets also. So x bar is your mean, sigma x is your standard deviation. So this is mostly known, x bar is mostly known, and x is the variable, and of course y is the another variable. Now if you see this equation 7.14 and you rearrange this equation, you'll get some equation for the yp is equals to minus log 1 minus p. This can be done easily, right, just by changing the sides and all. Now this yp for a probability, so you can change p to t, of course, because p is equals to 1 by t. So this yt will become minus log t by t minus 1. You can do a simple calculation, and now this can also be converted to log base 10, and you will get some constants here also. So now you got this equation. So yt for a given return period you can get from here. So this yt can be known. So are you getting the equation here? See, y is 1.285 x minus x bar over sigma x plus 0.577. This x bar will be mostly known, sigma x will be known. This y can be calculated for a given time period t from this equation or from this equation. So from there you can get the xt, that is for that particular written period you can get the xt. See here, this equation, if you see, if you rearrange this equation, what do you get? Let me rearrange this equation. You get y sigma x, you know, so that will be equals to 1.285 into x minus x bar, you know, and there will be some constant, let's call it minus 0.577 plus this equation equals to 1.285 x minus x bar. So this looks something like this, right? Xt equals to x bar plus k sigma x, because x and xt, this is xt, this is x bar, xt, x bar. Now the sigma x will come with y, sigma x will come with y, and this k is a constant, of course, you know. So this k becomes yt minus 0.577 over 1.2825. I hope this is clear, and this is applicable to an infinite sample size, remember that. Now for the practical application, how we are going to apply that? Practical application means when the data is not infinite but it's a finite. So xt is x bar plus k sigma n minus 1 here. So standard deviation you can calculate from this equation. K is the frequency factor, we know this, yt minus yn over sn. Now instead of this 0.577, 1.2825, we are using this yn and sn, right? Now this yt can be calculated from this equation or from this equation. Okay, so this is simply yt, you can calculate this yn bar and sn, you can calculate from these tables. So let's say some tables are given to us for different sample size. So this is the value for yn, and so you can see as your sample size increases, this value reaches to 0.577, and here also this value reaches to 1.2825 as the sample size increases. This is for the sn. Alright, so I hope this part is clear to you. Now to check if the data follows or not, we mostly use the Gumble's distribution, Gumble's probability paper. So on the x-axis we have the reduced variate yt, and on the y-axis we have the discharge, and definitely we'll get a straight line equation if you plot this data in terms of yt and qt. So you can see here, this here is the yt. So if you place this yt here, you will get xt is some constant plus yt. So this is a straight line with yt. Now that's how you will see it. This is a straight line with yt. And here the recurrence interval. Okay. So this is a linear scale, you can see here. And this is a logarithmic scale, because yt has a logarithmic relationship with the written period. So that's how you will get this a logarithmic scale. So this is the written period. Right. Now let's take another example. So in this example we are given with the floods in some river, and for the period is also given. We have to verify whether this follows the Gumble extreme value distribution or not, and then we have to estimate the flood discharge for 100 years and 150 years. So what we do, we arrange the data 1 2 3 4, highest to lowest, and for that we get the written period. Of course it's a 27 year data, so written period will be 28. Then it goes on decreasing, 14, 9.33. It's a simple formula, I hope you know. This is nothing but your n plus 1 by m, right? For m equals to 1, this becomes 28. You can see here, n is 27. X bar, the mean of this data, flood discharges is 4263. The standard deviation you can calculate. Now, from the table 7.3 and 7.4, for n equals to 27, you can calculate this yn and sn. 27, I think I don't have it here. Yeah, I have it here. So 0.5332 is the yn. Then you go for sn. 27 is 1.1004. So this we have used here. Okay, so you can calculate the yt. It comes out to be log. So this is log t by t minus 1. This how you get the 2.25037. From that you can calculate the k value, and then you can calculate the k is formula, simple formula. K is yt minus yn bar upon sn. This you can calculate. This is your yt, this is yn bar, and this is your sn bar. And xt is nothing but the mean value x bar plus this k value that you just calculated, 1.56 into sigma x. This is 1432 is your sigma n minus 1. Right. Now once you have calculated that, you can get the xt value for any written period. So this is this is for the written period. How much you got for the 10 years, you can do it for the 20 years, you can do it for the 5 years. You know, if it follows or not, what you can do is you can get the for different time periods, you can get the values of XT, and you can see if it follows the linear graph for YT versus XT. If it is linear, yes, it's a it follows the Gumble distribution. Right. This is another example here. You know, in this example, you are given with the mean annual flood 600 meter cube per second. So X bar is given to you, sigma n minus 1 also given to you, standard deviation XT. This equation we know very well. We have to find the probability of flood 1000 meter cube per second. Right? We have to estimate the probability actually that occurs within next 5. Yeah, so we have to use the Gumble's method here again. So we are given with X bar, we are given with sigma, right? We are given with this XT value. So we are already given with XT for T equals to 5 years. Na? So if you apply this equation, XT, this equation, XT equals to X bar plus K sigma n minus 1. This is known to you. This is known to you. This is known to you. So you can calculate K. You got the K. 2.667. Now this K, if you remember this K, it was yt minus yn bar over sn, right? You remember that. This was yt minus yn bar upon sn. Now, what is not known to you? So, here it says, if you assume that the data follows sample to be large, so it's given, sample size is very large, that's why this yn bar is 0.577 and this sn is 1.2825. So, from this equation, you can calculate the yt. Now yt is a function of written period, so from this equation you can get the written period 55 years. So this xt, so this t was not 5 years, so t we calculated as the 55 years. Now for this 55 years discharge, so discharge is 1000. Now this 1000 meter cube per second has a written period of 55 years. So what is its probability? Its probability is 1 by 55, correct? So this is 0.0182. Now this flood occurring at least once in 5 years will be 1 minus q raised to the power n. 1 minus q raised to the power n. So see, q raised to the power n means not occurring in first year, not occurring in second year, not occurring in third year, not occurring in fourth year, not occurring in fifth year. This makes it q raised to the power 5. If you remove this value from 1, that means it occurs at least once in the next 5 years. So this is how you can calculate it. Now Chow also gives some confidence limits. So from the same equation you can get the confidence limit. So for any function, we mostly for any data that we are predicting, we always apply a confidence interval. It's upper limit and the lower limit by how much confident we are with the data. No. So it's a simple formula. So X was see, XT you already know, XT was calculated. What we just have to do is, once we know this data, we just have to apply some plus minus to this data. That's how we calculate the confidence limits, right? So this formula is given as XT sum plus minus FC into standard error SE. Now this SE is a function of B, standard deviation, and the sample size, and B is a function of K. K is the frequency factor, you know, as given by 7.21. So we have seen this equation 7.21 here. Let me take you here, so this one. So K is same. So you have the value of K with you. You have the value of K with you. You have the value of B. Once you have the K, you have the B value. Once you have the B, standard deviation and the sample size, you have the SE. So this SE you can estimate from the K and standard deviation. Now FC is nothing but the percentage. Now you very well know that in the normal distribution, when you say, you remember that 95% of the data lies within 1.96 times the standard deviation. So that's how this FC comes, right? 68% within one standard deviation. So that's how this FC comes. So from this equation, you can calculate the confidence limit. So this data here shows, this example here shows how you can calculate the confidence limit for 95% and 80% confidence limits. What is the question? Question is, a period of 92 years of data is given, mean is given 6437 and the standard deviation is 2951. Gumble's method has to be used, written period of 500 years. Now you are given with the written period, you can calculate the y value, of course minus log t plus 1 by t, sorry, t by t minus 1, then k corresponding key can be found. Now it's given that 92 years of the data. So for the 92 years of data, you have to use the table 7.3 and 7.4 for n equals to 92 years. This is, although it's close by, but still you have to use this data. Now from there you can get the K500 values. Now you have to calculate the XT value. This is X500 X bar plus this K value times sigma. This comes out to be 320 meter cube per second. Now you have to calculate the confidence limits. For that you first need the B value. This is 1 plus 1.3 K plus 1.1 K square. You get this value. Then SE, of course, is the SE is B. We just calculate 5.61 B. This is the standard deviation. This is sample size root n. You get this SE. Now for 95% confidence interval, you have FC is 1.96. So this is the mean value, 2320 plus minus 1.96 into what is the value? SE. You just calculated SE. The same thing goes. So one is the plus, one is the minus. Correct? It's a simple question. The same thing you can do with 80%, whereas you have FC is 1.282 for the 80%. Right. Some major numbers you must remember, maybe this one you can remember. Others maybe not required. So this is log P3 distribution. Just like we have the Gumble, we have this log P3. Here what we do is we convert the discharges in the logarithmic case. So Z equals to log X, and instead of XT, actual discharges, we deal in the terms of Z plus KZ into sigma Z. Right? So Z bar is of course the mean, but in the logarithmic form. KZ is again a constant. Sigma Z is again the standard deviation, but in the logarithmic form. So this is a simple formula for the Z bar. Now this KZ value, right, is a function of CS and T. So there are a number of tables for the log P3. The tables require the value of the coefficient of skew CS and of course the return interval. Okay, so from that return interval and the CS, you can calculate the value of K. And what is the CS value? CS is the coefficient of skew. This is given by n z minus z bar q, n minus 1, n minus 2, sigma z whole cube. All these are standard terms. Sigma z, standard deviation, n is the sample size, z is the, of course, the discharge, z bar is the mean discharge in the log case. I think it's clear. Once you get the zt, you can get the xt. Right. So now design flood. Yeah, so the design flood. So we discussed in the beginning what is the design flood. Whenever we are designing a hydraulic structure, we have to consider the safety of the structure, and for the safety of the structure, we design it so that it lasts for a particular number of years. So there are a number of definitions for the design flood. So spillway design flood, it is used for the specific purpose of designing the spillway of structure, storage structures. This is specifically for the spillways. And there is a standard project flood, and then there is a probable maximum flood. So mostly the standard project flood is about 40 to 60% of the probable maximum flood. So whenever we need more safety, we go for the higher maximum flood value. So this is the, I think, highest probable maximum flood. This is the extreme flood that is physically possible in a region. This is severe most. So this is the extreme case for the floods. From the floods, we have some factors like risk and reliability. It's a simple equations. Like, so let's say the probability of occurrence of an event at least once over a period of n successive years is called the risk. Right? Probability of occurrence of an event occurring at least once over a period of n successive years is the risk. R. So risk is, we had seen that formula, that risk is 1 minus q raised to power n. So for the consecutive n years, if the flood is not occurring, this is called q raised to power n, and once in those n years the flood occurs, this is 1 minus q raised to power n, and where p is 1 by t. So this is your risk factor if you have the probability 1 by t. And reliability is the if you subtract this risk factor from 1, you get the reliability, right? And this is the safety factor. This I think you mostly apply in many studies. So this is actual value of the parameter divided by the parameter obtained from hydrologic consideration. So this is the safety factor. So mostly we apply a higher safety factors. Okay, so a simple couple of examples to calculate the risk factor. So a bridge has an expected life of 25 years. This is expected life, and it is designed full of for a flood magnitude of return period 100. So return period is given 100. So from this return period, you can get the probability. Once you have the probability, you can get the risk factor. Risk factor is 0.222. So the risk in this design is 22.2%. Of course, n is 25 years. Similarly, if 10% risk is acceptable, what is the return period? So risk is given as 10% using this equation, 0.10 equals to 1 minus 1 by t. From there, you can calculate the return period. This comes up to be 240 years. So risk is high, the return period is the expected life is less. If you go for lesser risk, your return period has to be higher. If return period is higher, that means your flood discharge will be higher. So you design for a higher flood discharge, as simple as that. It's a simple question, similar question that you can do it here. So this finishes your first lecture on floods. So I'll be uploading more lectures in the coming classes. Thank you.